My name is Luanne Freund, and I'm the acting director of the iSchool, the School of Library Archival and Information Studies. And it's my pleasure to welcome you all to our annual Research Day. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we're here on the traditional unceded land of the Musqueam people, and to thank them for being such gracious hosts. Research Day. Research Day is very dear to my heart. I think that we forget sometimes in the hustle and bustle of the academic year that research is really one of our main drivers, and for many of us, our main passion and reason for being here. And Research Day gives us a surprisingly rare opportunity to actually step back a bit, to reflect on what we're doing, and very importantly, to share what we're doing, to share both within the school, between students, faculty, with our broader community, and within the university. And I'm pleased that our speaker today is coming to us from another unit within arts, from political science, and that's one of the great ways that we use this day to share. The theme of the day today, access to information, perspectives on access to information, is very much core to what we do in the field. And I think if we think about access and its twin sister, preservation, that really covers a lot of what we do in this field and what makes our work so important to society in general, to democracy, to human rights, to values, what we value in Canadian society. And so I'm very proud and pleased to see the emphasis on this topic today. And I look forward myself to getting a chance to see the posters in more detail and hearing the talks, many of which, perhaps all of which, are given by students. So we love to see our graduate students up there presenting. So I'm going to hand over the podium, but I just want to start with a quick thank you. I'm sure we'll have more thank yous later, but a quick thank you to Dr. Arias Hernandez and Dr. Douglas, our colleagues, who put so much work and enthusiasm into planning this day, and to Professor Durante, who worked with them as chair of the Research Leadership Committee. And so I'll hand it over to Jennifer to introduce our speaker. Thank you and welcome.
Okay, so we're very pleased to be able to welcome Mark Warren to deliver today's keynote talk, which is titled The Participedia Project, Using an Open Source Platform to Mobilize Knowledge About Democratic Innovations. And Mark Warren holds the Harold and Dory Merrilees Chair for the Study of Democracy in the Department of Political Science here at UBC. He was the founding director of the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions at UBC and the co-founder of the Center for Democracy and Civil Society at Georgetown University. Warren is especially interested in democratic innovations, civil society and democratic governance, and political corruption. He is the author of Democracy and Association, the editor of Democracy and Trust, and co-editor of Designing Deliberative Democracy, the British Columbia Citizens Assembly. And he is currently directing the Participedia Project, which uses a web-based platform to collect data about democratic innovation and participatory governance around the world, and which is funded by a SHRC partnership grant. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Mark Warren.
Well, thank you so much. It's a privilege and an honor to be able to talk with you today about the Participedia Project, which is, as you now know, a project focused on mobilizing knowledge on participatory and democratic innovations around the world using an open source Creative Commons licensed web-based platform. Now, the easiest way to explain the Participedia Project is that it's a project that seeks to use a new way of absorbing what people know about democratic innovations around the world, and to do so in such a way that we can begin to develop the field of democratic innovation, use this knowledge for research, and then feed it back into practice. Now, we're still in the early days of development. Project started a number of years ago, but we didn't really get it going until this last summer and fall on the basis of a SHRC partnership grant led by UBC's Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions in Political Science. It started out as a collaboration between UBC and Harvard, but now we have this massive, sprawling partnership with 28 universities and NGO partners, as you can see on the slide. The School of Library, Archival, and Information Sciences is one of the partners on the grant for reasons that I hope will become apparent as I explain the project. Now, so what are the problems that motivate Participedia? Many of us who follow the development of democracy around the world believe that we're in the midst of a transformation of democracy, one that is maybe less dramatic, but no less important than the development of representative party-based democracy that evolved out of the spread of the universal franchise in the mid to late 19th century and through the 20th century and up until quite recently. The new transformation involves hundreds of thousands of new channels of citizen involvement in government in most countries of the world, often outside the more visible politics of electoral representation, and mostly driven by problems of governance in complex societies. Governance is hard, and centered governance is even harder. These new participatory processes vary widely in form. Participedia has already identified about 100 new named kinds of processes, although the actual really distinct number is probably somewhat smaller than this. Now, these innovations haven't popped up overnight. They're relatively recent, but there's a history, short history. In the developed democracies, innovations and participatory processes date to the post-World War II period, where they begin to appear in the form of legislated mandates for public hearings on administrative rulemaking. In the 1970s, urban planners begin to involve communities in planning processes, often in response to protests against bulldozing of neighborhoods, building freeways through city centers, and so on. The early 1980s saw the emergence of stakeholder meetings to address conflicts over environmental and land use issues. But new forms of citizen involvement and participation really began to blossom in the 1990s. And this was a decade of inventiveness that has continuing up until now. We now have, just to name a few of the processes, consensus conferences, facilitated town hall meetings, citizen juries, citizens' assemblies, deliberative polling, deliberative planning, participatory budgeting, study circles, planning cells, collaborative learning. Here in Vancouver, the city has even used a process called participatory theater to use narrative to reach hard-to-reach populations. The internet has expanded and deepened this proliferation with now probably hundreds of apps, wikis, and GIS-enabled platforms, pushed along by a new generation of civic technology organizations. In complex, pluralistic, rapidly changing societies such as Canada's, there are probably three forces that are driving driving these participatory innovations. Now, first, although electoral democracy produces broad mandates for government, it's not generating the legitimacy necessary for governing policy-specific areas, from environmental regulation-driven planning, from school reform to healthcare policy. That is, we elect governments, governments try to do stuff, people mobilize, the area is shut down, right? So that's structurally driving this area of innovation. Citizens are, secondly, increasingly vocal and better organized. They have the capacities to resist and undermine policies that are simply imposed, even by elected governments. Third, when they are engaged and organized, citizens have greater capacities than ever before to help solve public problems. So together, these factors are motivating this rapid development of participatory and potentially democratic innovations underneath and beside electoral democracy, and sometimes even within authoritarian contexts like China, which is very surprisingly clamping down on dissidents, but channeling political problems into new kinds of deliberative venues, creating possibly a more resilient form of authoritarianism. It's very interesting. Often ad hoc, piecemeal, segmented by policy, jurisdiction, level of government, when viewed as a whole, these innovations suggest that a global transformation in the nature and structure of democratic governance may be underway. So what do we need? We need to understand and map this emerging domain. We need something like a field guide to the species of participatory innovations and their local variations. We need to explain why these new political forms are being developed. As we build more information, we'll be better placed to ask and answer what at least we in political science think are really the interesting and important questions about these innovations. For example, what kinds of participatory innovations complement rather than compete with electoral democracy? What features of issues and policies are best dealt with through participatory processes? Is it possible to make ballot initiatives better by convening citizen panels in advance of voting? How can desirable features of small-scale processes, such as focused deliberation, be scaled to broader publics? Under what conditions do political decision makers have incentives to experiment with democratic innovations? We also need to be attentive to the many processes that are advertised by political elites as democratic, but really function to favor well-organized groups, co-opt dissent, reinforce clientelism, or merely serve symbolic purposes with little connection to real decision-making. I haven't come up with a very good name for this, but I've been calling it democracy washing. It's parallel to greenwashing, so that you see the point. So to answer questions like these, we need to develop a common pool resource of information. But the rapid development and huge diversity of innovations presents us with a huge challenge for research. Now, to appreciate the challenge, at least in political science, compare our extensive knowledge of electoral systems and voting behavior. You know, we political scientists know what kinds of electoral systems exist. We have extensive knowledge of the interaction between electoral systems and design of electoral systems and the context within which they operate. There are large data projects, such as the comparative studies of electoral systems that support, that aggregate information from lots of small teams of researchers and then support these teams by feeding back the information. We don't have anything like this kind of resource for this emerging domain of participatory and potentially democratic innovation. No official statistics or records are collected. Indeed, we don't even have generally accepted taxonomies that might guide a collection such as this. So how are we meeting this challenge? Rather than trying to develop a large research team to build out the field, right, that would be the comparative election studies way of doing this, we're building a web-based research platform that should enable decentralized, collaborative creation of knowledge that will be far more extensive than anything that we might be able to achieve with a traditionally organized research team. Our original inspiration was from crowdsourcing projects in the natural sciences, like Galaxy Zoo, and there are a number of others out there. Our problem is different in kind, and in some ways more complex, but it does have characteristics that should make it a good candidate for crowdsourcing-like models. The domain is complex and quickly evolving, so we need information from lots of places. There's widespread knowledge of the domain, often in the form of localized practical knowledge and case studies, But the knowledge is dispersed and uncoordinated. You know, it's not systematic, it's not centralized, it's out there, and we don't have it. Our ideal simply is to develop a research platform that will enable hundreds, and we hope thousands of individuals and small teams to contribute what they know to a common pool of knowledge, piece by piece, place by place, process by process. Ideally, we can mobilize knowledge from dispersed communities of research and practice, while at the same time developing and integrating a research community that reaches across countries, across levels of government, across institutions, involving not only academics and professionals, including an increasingly large number of professional democratic innovation practitioners, but also interested amateurs and students. And ideally, we're trying to create a research platform without high barriers of entry and the rigidities of more traditional research networks. So here's a screenshot of our Create Content page. We'll have a refreshed version of this up within a few months. But this is the kind of ask that we make we make of people who create an account and log into to Participedia. We're hoping that in this way we'll become a model in the social sciences of open source, Creative Commons licensed participatory research with relatively high quality information, information that is comparable across contexts, and information that is freely available to anyone. From a research perspective, it should become a resource that allows us to move beyond what we have now, which is small ethnographic studies of democratic innovations into large comparative evidence-based research. Now, as we create this information resource, we're trying to work to relatively high standards. We haven't quite gotten there yet, but we will. The information needs to be comprehensive enough to map this emerging domain of participatory governance, anticipating new kinds of processes. It needs to be fine-grained enough to distinguish among many and perhaps hundreds of different kinds of processes, as well as to underwrite fairly precise context-sensitive explanations and assessments. And it should be usable for a variety of communities in spite of its internal complexity. In addition, we hope to be making this available in a number of languages beyond English. So far, we're doing it the cheap way, which is a Google Translate button. We will hope to do better than that. So how are we going to get there? How does Participedia actually work? Now, the user interface of Participedia is structured by user-contributed articles that anchor and organize associated data. We have three general classifications of entries. The most important of these, in our view, are descriptions of cases of participatory or democratic innovation with associated data, cases like the British Columbia Citizens Assembly and Electoral Reform, which a few of you may remember, participatory budgeting in Porto Alegre, Brazil, or deliberative polling in Wenliang City, China. The cases are the building blocks of the database, and so in some sense, the primary units of analysis. We have about 500 cases on the website at this point. This is just a tiny selection of a universe that we don't know. We don't actually know how big it is, but we suspect that there are hundreds of thousands of these things now going on across the world in any given year. Then we have descriptions, a second class descriptions of methods of democratic or participatory innovation. Methods or processes like citizens' juries or deliberative polling or participatory budgeting. Now the methods section of Participedia enables generalized knowledge about democratic innovations. We're especially interested in identifying what works, optimal methods for specific kinds of problems and contexts. We have about 100 entries under the methods category. We don't think there are actually this many distinct processes, but this area is now full of democracy entrepreneurs, and every democracy entrepreneur names their own method and tries to sell it. So we get a proliferation of these sorts of things. And then finally, we have an organization category. We have this there simply because we know there are a lot of people out there who want to advertise what they're doing in the democratic innovation area. These will be organizations like Civicus or Involve or the now defunct but once famous America Speaks. We have 370 or 380 organizations that have sort of planted their flag in this part of the website. These descriptions follow descriptions, the articles that are the front face of these things follow a common outline. So our suggested case outline, for example, asks for purposes, history, structure, methods of deliberation, decision-making, outcomes, and criticisms. Now, you can see here on this slide the first pieces of an article on a deliberative process that looked at the issue of biobanking in British Columbia, which you may or may not have heard of, but this is the kind of thing where a government will convene a process that nobody has heard of, but they will hear of it if it screws up, right? So they will ask people, educate them about what it is, and then ask them what could possibly go wrong. Descriptions are open to multi-author editing following a wiki model, although we're going to experiment with locked down cases to address issues of accountability and trust that are important to some kinds of contributors, and especially important to officials and government agencies who might be held accountable for the content that they post. Participedia is not primarily, though, a wiki-based project, but rather a data-building project. So attached to each case are requests for data that will allow us to map and to categorize cases, such as location, dates, duration, number of participants, sponsoring organizations or governments, policy area, social issues, the social issue, the purposes and goals of sponsors and participants, methods of participant selection, finances, where they come from, and so on. The current version of Participedia includes about 30 of these kinds of variables for each case. You can see here, you probably actually can't see very well, but there are kind of forms behind each case that that make very specific asks of this kind. you know, if you want to have a look later on, you can get into this simply by going to Participedia, creating an account, it's a very low bar, and then logging in, find a case, click on edit, you'll reveal all of this. Future versions of Participedia, hopefully within the next several months, will include survey batteries that we're going to plug into the website so that we can gather opinion-like data on a much broader range of variables. We'll have one set of basic surveys for participants in processes and another for knowledgeable observers and experts, such as academics or experts who are familiar with the case. Here we're following the kind of Wikipedia model in that if you think you're an expert, you're an expert, right? We want to know what you think. Our surveys of participants will ask about experiences of conflict and cooperation, quality of deliberation, inclusiveness, the knowledge requirements, the representativeness of a process relative to the public that it's about, and so on. Our surveys of knowledgeable observers will ask about external factors relevant to successes and failures, such as the goals of participants and organizers, participant selection processes, methods of facilitation, which turn out to be quite important, engagement of stakeholders, the weight of interest groups, right? Are they pushing the process around? The electoral context, and so on. Now, when the survey-based data gathering tools are complete, we're hoping to collect another 40 or 50 data points for each of these surveys, so probably 80 to 100 kinds of responses. These are the kinds of things that are then aggregated by researchers into variables of interest. We'll also be providing the capacity for organizers and others to create survey modules that are specific to an issue, an event or a process built right into the website. We're hoping that the surveys can become useful evaluation tools that organizers of events or governments will want to use and that will become a kind of incentive to contribute. Okay, so let's now dive just a little bit deeper. How do we know what kinds of questions we need to ask to elicit the kinds of data that will build our knowledge? The short answer is just that we've made guesses, but we hope they're educated guesses. They're guesses that come out of a combination of democratic theory, institutional analysis, and political science and case studies. So let me say a little bit more about each of these. Now, first, in the area of democratic theory, a small number of democratic theorists have begun to map participatory innovations by abstracting the normative goods that are part of democracy. For example, democracy is a cluster concept that includes things like, on the normative side, inclusion, popular control, legitimacy, transparency, effectiveness, and so on. These are sorted out from specific devices that are often associated with democracy, such as competitive elections, voting, debate, and so on. Once we separate norms from devices or institutions, we can ask what kinds of processes and institutional devices, deliberation, protest, voting, representative sampling, staged techniques, and so on, are more or less likely to produce normatively desirable effects like legitimacy or transparency or responsiveness. Now, our guess is that despite the huge diversity amongst participatory innovations, there's a finite number of political devices, practices, and institutional mechanisms that combine in differing ways under a variety of contexts. If we can identify and abstract these, then we can begin to compare their effects across contexts. Now, just as important, by defining democracy in terms of clusters of normative goods, we can look for democratic effects in novel and innovative political practices without prejudging that these practices or innovations contribute to democracy just because they happen to involve a practice like a public hearing or voting. Or this kind of thing. Now, second, in the area of institutional research, we now have partial understandings of the ways basic institutional mechanisms produce or undermine specific goods and purposes that are associated with democracy. We have increasingly comprehensive accounts of deliberative public engagement as a governance technique. We also have increasingly fine-grained integrations of deliberative democratic theory and experimental research in social psychology. There are experimenters who will take a group of 10, give them a deliberative problem, and then vary various configurations. Perhaps the decision rule, majority rule versus consensus. Or maybe the number of men and number of women. It turns out if you have just a couple of men, there's a rooster effect. They work hard to dominate the conversation. If you do 50-50, then the men behave themselves. So we have a lot of interesting stuff like that about how to design good deliberative processes. We're beginning to understand how specific features of institutional design help or hinder deliberation or inclusion or decision making or other dimensions of democracy. For example, we know that if we near randomly or randomly select participants for a citizen body charged with a task, for example, there was a citizens assembly in Grandview, in the Grandview Woodland neighborhood that wrapped up several months ago, actually last summer. They did a more or less random draw from the neighborhood. In this way, they were able to include people who would never have been included in a public process. If you have self-selection, to take Grandview Woodlawn, the people who show up are older, whiter homeowners, right? Homeowners only make up about 35% of the neighborhood. Renters don't show up to these things. Young people don't show up. People of color don't show up. And so on. So we know a lot now about how to get new perspectives, better representation into these kinds of processes. There are some interesting experiments with combining citizens' juries with referendums, so that when people walk into the ballot booth, they will have been prompted to think about an issue before they look at their ballot. This is the Oregon Citizens Initiative Review process, which is really a very interesting innovation. So we've got a lot of this stuff. Third, we've got deep knowledge of a lot of cases. The British Columbia Citizens Assembly was very well studied. We know a lot about participatory budgeting in Brazil and other parts of the world. We have quite a few policy-specific case studies, especially in health, environment, and community development. So the theoretical structure of Participedia builds on these developments to structure the underlying model that we then use to ask for contributions to our common pool of knowledge. Now, for those who, I hope this doesn't get too political science geeky for you, but for those of you who think in the language of variables, we treat a variety of possible normative outcomes that are part of the concept of democracy and good government. Again, ideals like deliberative judgment, representativeness, effectiveness, decisiveness, trust building, and so on, as dependent variables. That is, they're the outcomes that we care about in research. Our independent variables include three broad kinds. First, there are features of an issue and its context, such as the complexity of an issue, the level of polarization in the environment, the available resources, the timing relative to electoral cycles, and so on, that we take as given for any particular case, right? That's why it's independent. Second, there are features of institutional design, methods of selection, representativeness of a relevant population, modes of facilitation, sequencing of techniques, relation to decision-making institutions like city councils and so on, which could, in principle, be varied rather than just given. And third, there will be other relevant independent variables that can be constructed from other kinds of data sources, such as demographic or election data or data on human development. So, for example, if we want to know whether participants in a process were representative of a relevant public, we would compare characteristics of participants, which we would be collecting through the participant surveys, with demographic information from census data. So what do we get for all this effort? At the most general level, we're hoping that we'll be able to develop a map or a taxonomy of participatory democratic stuff. We want to know what the landscape looks like. It will be an advance in knowledge just to find out what kinds of species are out there. As the data becomes thicker, we should be able to answer interesting questions of the kind that I alluded to above. For example, what kinds of participatory innovations complement rather than compete with electoral democracy? And finally, ultimately, we want to ask the big question. What kinds of participatory or democratic innovations are actually working to deepen democracy? Which are producing better, more effective, sustainable, more sustainable public policies? And on the negative side, what kinds of processes are built mostly for show, to give the appearance that decision makers are consulting citizens without actually giving them much in the way of influence? What are the characteristics of processes that produce worse policies or lead to more cynicism and disaffection among citizens? Now, this is the kind of project that won't develop without developing a parallel community of people who provide content. So it's not a true crowdsourcing project. It's a dual-track collaborative platform that makes it easy for hundreds and maybe thousands of people to collaborate. And then it's a community building, a research community building project on the other side. So while the infrastructure of Participedia is going to mostly be university-based, it is mostly university-based, we need to build out this community. Again, we don't think it needs to be huge. I mean, in political science, we're used to working with teams of 5, 6, 7, 10 people. If we get our community up to several hundreds, or possibly several thousands, so we have about, 2100 or 2200 people who are registered on Participedia, this would be a great leap forward in terms of the extensiveness of a research community. We don't quite have this community yet. The platform is not where we want it to be. Hopefully it will be in a year's time. We're driving most of the content now with students, graduate student labor, a lot of that. But interestingly, a number of professors have assigned Participedia entries as projects rather than term papers. So some of our content comes from classes, from term research papers, in effect. Students really like this, right? Rather than the paper ending up in the corner of my office and gathering dust, it's out there, and it's a little bit of a contribution to something that is really important. So we kind of know how to do this on the academic side. We have to work harder to get information from sort of democracy practitioners. They're all really busy, they're underfunded, they're overstretched, and this is usually the last thing that they want to do. And so we need to kind of figure out what the value proposition is for people who aren't hooked in through academics. So at some point in time, this is probably a couple of years out, think that we can begin to develop kind of standardized assessment tools for public participation, citizen engagement processes. Governments really do want to know whether the money that they're spending on these things is well spent, and we ought to be able to help address that. We can do things like, we will be able to do things like build broad comparative assessment tools as the data becomes thicker and deeper. You know, a participation index might measure the relative levels of public participation in some political jurisdiction, which, like other kinds of democracy indexes, and there are a lot of them out there now, can be cross-correlated to other social indicators. We'll also experiment with creating a new version of the International Association for Public Participation Spectrum of Public Participation, which you probably have never heard of, but which, you know, the departments and governments that are charged with doing this stuff, they all use this. We think we can do better than they do. We plan to develop quality indicators based on the presence or absence of good design features. So at some point in the future, we might even be able to develop something like the LED certification program for energy efficiency, but will do it for democracy and for these democratic innovations. We know we need to build a number of other kinds of features into the website. A high priority is going to be to figure out how to manage and integrate existing data by creating a repository for data sets and for academic and gray literature. There's a lot of gray literature in this area. At some point, when we become a little more sophisticated, we'll fool around with application programming interfaces, APIs, that will allow our database to speak to other databases, and so on. We also needed to create trust in Participedia. Some of our contributors, especially government agencies with clear organizational lines of accountability, will only contribute if we can assure that their contributions won't be revised or possibly sabotaged, which does happen. This is one of the areas that we hope that our partnership with the School of Library, Archival, and Information Studies will help with. We need to find a model that both speaks to trust needs and retains our open source, open community ethos. And we haven't really figured this out yet. So this is what we're going to need from, one of the many things that we will need from you guys. We're also hoping to get from you all some insight, maybe some cases in empowering citizens through information. Without information, and without information that is well organized and usable, there's no democracy, right? People don't know what it is that they are vetoing, fighting against, fighting for, assessing, holding accountable. One of the revolutions in participatory innovation has been in open access, well-organized information. We only have the tiniest bit of that on our website now, but it is a big picture, a big part of the bigger puzzle. I think I'll just wrap it up there. Thank you so much. And if you've, I think we've got a few moments for questions, comments, thoughts.
Thanks. Thank you, Dr. Warren. That was really, really fascinating. And I was particularly interested in your term democracy washing. And I wonder in what way that's parallel to the kind of openness washing that I hear about going on in governments that are pretending that they are participating in open government. But in fact, we know that very detailed and rich information is actually being removed from their websites and simplified information being put up and touted as part of their open government initiatives. And I wonder if you could speak to that.
I don't think I have any more insight than what you've just offered. There's a huge demand for open information, open government, and a huge resistance. British Columbia is not in the vanguard here. Indeed, Canada's not in the vanguard. There are municipalities in the U.S. that have done a fairly good job of this. But it's a problem. I think it's just a struggle. None of this comes easily. Information is power, and embarrassing information undermines power. The best thing for a political office holder or a bureaucrat to do is to be able to control their image, the information, how they're doing, and the incentives to, I don't know what you call it, information wash, openness wash. I mean, there are all these phenomena that we need good terms for these things. We don't quite have them yet, so that would be a start, just to label them. I don't think I have much more insight. You know, it's one of these things where, advocacy groups are getting better and better at kind of outing poor information. But this is a movement that is real, as you know, it's 30 years old. I think these are the sort of first Freedom of Information Acts, the first Sunshine Laws. If you look at who uses Freedom of Information Acts across the OECD democracies, 95% of it is usually corporate interest groups trying to shake down public records for trade secrets and these sorts of things. We need more advocacy groups that focus on freedom of information, because most of us as individuals, we can't actually use the tools that are there.
Thank you. Yeah, lots of ideas coming from that. Some input I can provide maybe is participating in the open government meeting in Ottawa last summer. There was a lot of democracy washing going on there. But the big theme there for the participants interested in the open data movement was the need to shift to evaluation. That there was a lot of work done to push the open data movement to get data sets shared, but not a lot of evaluation. So I was intrigued by your model of posting cases and then collecting surveys. Could you maybe just talk a little bit more about that? In particular, I'm curious if the surveys will also be open, or if those are really research data, and how having public responses to the cases might deter people from posting cases. So how do you handle that?
Our hope is that we can, our computer people are working on figuring out how to seamlessly integrate surveys into the website, so that along with answering questions about location, finances, and so on, there will be a prompt to go to the opinion side where people will address questions of how well things are working in a number of different kinds of dimensions. And then our hope is that we can begin to build that out into evaluation tools. This is a The area of evaluation is something that virtually everybody wants, but it isn't really there yet. At the macro level, it's very hard to evaluate any of these sorts of things because although we know that good government is hugely important, right? It's associated with everything else that is good. Human development, health, education, prosperity, security and safety, being able to self-determine. All these good things are associated with democracy. But the incremental contribution of any given process is just a drop in the bucket of all of the other things that are influencing outcomes. So it's hard to do. We're hoping that we can get a little bit of a handle by working through participants, working through observers on particular processes.
Good luck.
Yes. We're a little bit daunted by our ambitions, but we know we need to do it.
So just comparing the situation of participating with regular instances of participation in which people self-select to provide information or to be there, are you guys seeing something different in Participedia?
Sorry.
An invitation for...
Sorry, just start that last sentence.
Right, so comparing the participation in Participedia with participation in other fora, in which people normally self-select themselves, mm-hmm. to provide, for example, cases, methods, organizations. So have you seen like the same kind of like pattern? Because you mentioned, for example, white people, you know, homeowners, you know, people who are well-educated. Are you seeing something different here? People from, coming, for example, from First Nations, minorities, providing, you know, information about what they are doing in terms of democratic innovations?
Yeah, so this is, and this is a problem that we're quite worried about. You know, because we started as a North American First World project, our initial biases are toward, you know, North American content. Our first partners were in Europe, so we still have that first world bias. In developing the partnership grant, we worked on adding partners from other places and continents, and so we're trying to build out you know, our network so that we begin to get new kinds of contributions from especially from places that are less accessible. One of the things that we know that we need to do is although I've been talking about Participedia as a low bar of entry, in fact, it's still quite high, right? So we're working on kind of much easier versions of Participedia so that we at least know what's out there. If we know what's out there, then we can, for example, assign students to go in, you know, to research, to fill in the case, to develop it out. Now, behind this is a broader kind of social science problem. We don't know, so we've got 500 some cases. We don't know what that sample represents. We don't know the universe from which that sample is drawn. So what we're trying to do now is to push our partners, this will be over the next few years, to take a particular policy area or a particular region and try to do a kind of a survey and just kind of start cases so that we know you know, what the universe looks like from which we're sampling. So there's that kind of bias problem too.
Yes, sorry, I'm hiding behind the pearl. Thank you very much for your talk. It was very, very generative, as Luann already pointed out. And I have a lot of different questions, so I'm having trouble just picking one. But as often happens, when you lay out so much before you, someone gets hooked on one particular thing that you put out as an aside. And this was when you were referring to some of these more participatory methods being used to bolster non-democratic governments, and that's quite intriguing. And do you feel like that potentially was just an aside, or do you feel as though this project might actually shed some light on that?
We are hoping to shed some light. So we have Tsinghua University and Peking University as partners, and China's sort of Exhibit A in the attempt by the Communist Party to use really new and in some cases quite innovative deliberative processes, in effect to co-opt protest. So Communist Party officials, especially at the municipal level, are judged, and their upward mobility depends on the amount of harmony in their area of jurisdiction. What the Central Communist Party has figured out is that lower level officials can ask people what they're worried about, right? And if the asking is of the right kind, protests on down the road, and there are probably somewhere, the governments are no longer publishing these figures, but probably 150,000 public actions of one sort or another in China every year now. The party doesn't like this, so they are devising processes to retain order. So they're combining this with clamping down on anything that looks like mobilization broadly, anything that threatens the leadership of the Communist Party. That's the kind of kicker. anything below that, they're kind of happy to construct things that actually may have pretty good democratic and deliberative credentials. You add it all up, and it is, you know, it doesn't get us all the way to a robust, deep democratic regime. It gets us to a more sensitive, responsive form of authoritarianism. That's better than unresponsive authoritarianism, but it's a new, interesting hybrid. China's not the only case. So we want to be on the lookout for this, right? And again, this goes to the point that officials can call things representative or responsive or democratic or lots of other good things. We want to go in and look and ask participants, ask knowledgeable observers what's going on here.